lives. You see they're dry. You see there's no marrow in the bone. You see they're scattered all over the valley. They ain't even full skeletons. I mean, the bones are scattered all over the valley. They're just bones. But answer me a question, Ezekiel. Can these bones live? Ezekiel answers the only way he knows how to answer. Lord, you know. Critical race theory was born out of critical legal theory. Am I teaching y'all something today? There emerged two common beliefs linking all critical race theories. First, white supremacy has subordinated black people and other people of color. That's just a fact. How in the world are you going to fight against that being taught in any school? White supremacy has subordinated black people and other people of color. That's a fact. Why don't you want that to be taught in school? You let your schools teach us that Columbus discovered America. That's a lie. You let your schools teach us that George Washington couldn't tell a lie. That's a lie. You let your schools teach us that some slave owners were beneficent and good slave owners. There were no good slave owners. Anybody who owned people was evil. That's a lie. You let your schools teach us that Abraham Lincoln was good for Negroes. No, Abraham Lincoln was trying to save the Union. And Abe Lincoln himself said if he could save the Union and keep black people in chains, he would do it. That's a lie. Come on, somebody. You let them teach us about a white Jesus. You let them teach us that Native Americans were the aggressors. Come on, somebody. That white folk had a manifest destiny and that the pilgrims were good to Native Americans. That's a lie. All day, every day, you let them teach us lies. All throughout my history in school, I was taught lies. But you got a problem with critical race theory. Because it teaches the truth that white supremacy has subordinated black people and people of color. The right to bear arms. Let me just back up a little bit and let me take you on back to the late 1960s when Ronald Reagan was the governor of California. And they were oppressing black folk, and a group of men and women known as the Black Panther Party decided that they were going to defend the rights of black folk. And the Black Panthers decided that the Second Amendment wasn't just for white folk. So they strapped themselves with guns and showed up at the Capitol in California. And when they saw them Negroes with guns, come on, somebody. That's why I say, if you ever really want to get gun laws changed, just strap all these Negroes up. They'll change them laws before the week is over. When the Black Panthers, watch this. I want you to read. The California legislator passed what was called the Mulford Act. It was a gun control act that decided who could get guns, who couldn't get guns, what could be in your background, what couldn't be in your background. It was the first time in history that the National Rifle Association, the NRA, supported restrictive gun legislation, all because black folk had the nerve to get strapped. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, go get strapped. Amen, somebody. Y'all gonna say Bishop told us to get strapped. I said it. Go get strapped. It just got real quiet up in here. But y'all already know I'm a triple P. Amen. Y'all know what a triple P is, right? A pistol packing preacher. Amen, somebody.
Thank you, Jesus. got a responsibility to go back to Lodabar. Your work's not done just because you made it to the palace. Bless the name of the Lord. But you got a responsibility.
What's up, Graham?
To somebody else make it across.
What's up, Facebookers? YouTubers? Twitter Spacers. Happy MLK Day. Let's get it. Rep your city, rep your town. Let me know where you're chiming in from. Tell a friend we on the air right now. All right, y'all. Let's do this. Peace, book. What's happening, y'all?
Thank you, Jesus.
I got a song I'm going to dedicate to all of you faithful Cowboy fans. You're going to love it. Y'all going to love it. So I'm shouting out all the Cowboy fans, Bishop Rudolph McKissick, Howard John Wesley. Who else is out there? Reverend Mark Bayman, so many of y'all. I'm praying for y'all today. Kenneth Barnett, I'm praying for y'all today. Angela Thorpe.
I'm gonna get what belongs to me.
Yeah, all you Cowboy fans. Them boys.
Sometimes God got to strip what you got to so you don't depend on yourself. He got to take away from you so you understand how to depend on El Shaddai. Come on in here. Jails are full.
90.7 WTCC. Good morning and welcome to another edition of The Spoken Word. I'm your host, Bishop Talbert Swan II. And as usual, we'll be telling it like it is through cultural idioms and nuances that shape the order, ethos, and chaos of the African-American experience. Words have their own vitality. They shape their own consciousness and create their own context for interpreting social and spiritual reality. The spoken word contains the power to reshape the landscape of society. It is 5 minutes past the hour of 9 a.m. I want to thank Mr. Kenneth Barnett for bringing us up until the 9 o'clock hour with the promise. You can hear the promise every Monday morning from 6 a.m. to 9 a.m., bringing you the best in gospel music. Good way to start out your Monday morning. Great way to start out your week. Today is MLK Day. It is the federally observed holiday set aside to remember the life and the legacy of the late Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So today we're going to talk about MLK. We're going to play some clips from MLK, everything about MLK. I'll take your telephone calls. Y'all tell me how MLK has inspired you. What are the quotes that you love from MLK? Because, you know, there's one in particular that they always quote But I'm going to give y'all some other quotes. Some of the more radical quotes that you don't hear. You don't hear about it. You don't hear about these quotes because they don't want you to know about this Dr. King. You remember just on Friday, I talked about how they have sanitized and domesticized Dr. King to make him palatable. We're going to talk about those quotes that are too radical to whitewash. They couldn't whitewash these quotes from Dr. King. And I'll play my favorite Dr. King speech. And I'll take your telephone calls, 413-736-2781. And if you're looking for a place to go to celebrate, go on down to the Mass Mutual Center. I believe from 9 a.m. to 1. It's happening right now. Going on right now. I'll be going down after I get off the radio. My granddaughter, Naomi, is playing a little piano for the community music school. So I got to go see my grandbaby. My son, Lazine, is part of a presentation by the Divine Nine. He's an iota, of course. Y'all see the shirt. Y'all see the shirt. Y'all see the Theta Man shirt. He's a legacy. My wife and my son and me, and we're going down to check out the festivities from the MLK Collective downtown. So if you're in the 413, that's the place to be this morning, is right down at the Mass Mutual Center. But we're talking about the drum major for justice, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., all right? Or as they say in Coming to America, Martin Luther the King, okay? I see you, Frat. I see you, Stanley. Put in the comment section your favorite MLK quote, your favorite MLK quote. Rep your city, rep your town. Pensauken, New Jersey in the house. Harrisburg, Pennsylvania is up in the building. Raleigh, North Carolina is in the building. Houston is doubly and triply in the building. Camden, Arkansas. I thought it was New Jersey, but Camden, Arkansas is up in the building. Springfield, Massachusetts is in the house. Chicago, Illinois is in the building. Kansas City, Kansas is in the building. Where y'all at? Okay, I see y'all checking in on the gram. Tucson, Arizona is in the building. Coconona, good morning to you, sis. Charlotte, North Carolina. Lady Hilliard, good morning to you. Minister Poet from Seattle, Washington is in the building. I see you, Drayton Brown. Good morning, sir. Brooklyn, New York is up in the house. Yes, justice for all. Rep your city, rep your town. Tell a friend, tell somebody. We're on the air right now. We're talking about the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Washington State. I don't know where, but good morning to you. I see you. Deacon Lovejoy, good morning to you, sir. Yes, 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 yes. Who else we got up in here? I see my brother up in the building, Jonathan Swan. He's checking in with his favorite MLK quote. Let me put that up there so y'all can see it. As his favorite MLK quote. I see Ty Hamer's putting his favorite quote. Yeah, stick your favorite quote up in there. We'll highlight some of them. We'll highlight some of them. I see Boiling Springs, North Kakalaki is in the building. Get your favorite Dr. King quotes in the building. Get them on deck. We're going to highlight some of them We'll be right back. Don't y'all go nowhere. We're coming right back.
But the essence of growth is change. The being in the road would be the end of the road if you refuse to change.
Reach a little higher, reach a little higher, dig a little deeper, dig a little deeper, go a little further, come on, come on, come on,
reach a little higher,
come on, yeah.
Dig a little deeper,
dig a little deeper,
go a little further,
go a little further.
Don't stop.
Come on, don't stop.
The essence of life is growth, but the essence of growth is change. The being in the road will be the end of the road if you refuse to change. Your life will never change until you get disgusted with where you are. Whatever you don't hate is what you tolerate. You must learn from the past, plan for the future, and live for today. For it is your daily routine that determines your success or failure in life. It's the choices that you have made up until this point that will determine the rest of your life. So break the cycle that doing enough is simply good enough. You only get out what you put in, so don't settle.
All right, what's good, y'all?
So push yourself. Push me, y'all.
Rep your city, rep your town.
Reach a little higher.
Dig a little deeper.
Dig a little deeper.
Go a little further.
Don't stop. Come on.
Finish my lemon loaf.
Reach a little higher.
Dig a little deeper.
Dig a little deeper.
Go a little further.
Go a little further. Don't stop.
Don't stop.
Don't stop.
Don't stop.
So you gotta break the routine of trying to beat the system. Manipulators will always try to bypass the process for the quick progress. There are no shortcuts to success. There are no elevators to the top. You gotta take it one step at a time. You gotta break the routine of allowing others to get into your head to control who you are and where you're going. You see, when you're about the positive, you're gonna always have haters. But don't let your haters push you down. Let your haters push you forward to the next.
Good one, Lady Hilliard.
People show you who they really are. Don't perceive them to be something else that they're not. See, a zebra does not change his stripes. So you gotta keep pushing yourself to the next level. Yeah, there you go.
Lady Hilliard's favorite quote, I have decided to stick with love. Hate is too great a burden to bear.
Come on, come on. You gotta understand the greatness is the nature that you were born out of. You'll never discover your greatness without hard work and dedication. Greatness says more about who you are and what you expect for yourself. And greatness will always attract greatness. Show me your friends and I'll show you the future. The future will be just a step away.
Step away.
Step away. You're just a step away. Don't ever give up. Come on. You're just a step away. You're almost there. Come on. You got to push yourself beyond your limitations.
Good morning, Aunt Marion.
No valley too low.
I see you.
You can go where you want to go. It's all in the power of your imagination. If you can see the invisible.
Let me get some of these quotes in here. Stretch yourself, reach a little higher, dig a little deeper, go a little further. Jonathan Swan's quote, it is not possible to be in favor of justice for some people and not be in favor of justice for all people. All right. Let's see, what other quotes we got in here? Yeah, Stanley Washington, my frat brother. A riot is the language of the people. Some versions say a riot is the language of the unheard. Yes, sir. We're getting your favorite quotes from Dr. King. Lessons learned from Dr. King. It is Martin Luther King Jr. Day. All right, Minister Poet says we must accept finite disappointment, but never lose infinite hope. Lady Hilliard said, I have decided to stick with love. Hate is too great a burden to bear. All right. Let's see. That deacon, in the end, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. Yes, 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 yes. We are getting your MLK quotes up in here. It is MLK Day. I'm going to play some other MLK stuff. I got a song to dedicate to all of the Cowboy fans. Yeah, yeah. Right after this, right after this. Stay with us. Don't go nowhere.
In the mirror, and I like what I see. A strong, beautiful black woman staring back at me. One who's seen a lot of pain and had her share of sorrow, but who never gave up hope for a brighter tomorrow. I've been lied to, cheated on, stolen from, and hit. But it just made me stronger, and I refuse to quit.
That's right.
And though I've been tempted, I refuse to stoop to their level.
Don't go down.
I rose above that nonsense and made a liar of the devil.
All right now.
The devil who said I wasn't good enough, cute enough, or worthy of love. I kicked his butt with divine power from above. Power that says I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. And brought me out of darkness so that I could see. That I'm smart, I'm beautiful, I'm a child of the King. Abundant love for me, he came to bring. Oh yes, when I look in the mirror, I love what I see. That strong, beautiful black woman, that woman is me.
90.7 WTCC. Good morning to each and every one of you on this Martin Luther King Jr. holiday. We kicked off this weekend with our annual flag raising and MLK ceremony at City Hall. We had our annual MLK worship experience both on Sunday morning at our local church and along with the pastor's council last night. The Reverend Dr. Ray Hammond was the preacher. We culminate with activities that are happening at Mass Mutual Center. Well, they've already kicked off as of 9 a.m. They will continue until 1. So if you're in the 413, definitely go and check out everything that's happening. We're taking your MLK quote, all that stuff. Deacon George Lovejoy put this quote in. We know through painful experiences that freedom is never voluntary given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. That's from his letter from a Birmingham jail. So we're getting your favorite quotes. Rep your city, rep your town. Good morning to Aunt Marion. I also want to give a shout out to my family and condolences on the loss of our aunt, Maxine Sherman, my mother's sister and Aunt Marion's sister, the three sisters. She transitioned and went home to be with the Lord. And we definitely mourn that loss. So to my cousins, Marcus and Jean, certainly our prayers are with you and our support is always with you. Every time I open up this window in the studio, it never fails that an ambulance or something goes roaring by here. But in any case, and to each of you who have lost loved ones, Sheila B says on YouTube, says one of her favorite MLK quotes is, "Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that." Ty Hamer, who's also on YouTube, says, "Keep Martin Luther King in the background and God on the foreground. and even everything will be all right. You are a channel of the gospel, not the source. All right, so we're taking your MLK quotes. We're going to highlight some of those MLK quotes that are your favorites. And you know what I'm happy in seeing here is it's not the typical, you know, content of your character quotes that we normally get. We're seeing a myriad of other quotes that are being highlighted by Dr. King. And like I said, I'm going to play some clips from two speeches if we have time. Make sure we do that. And we'll take your telephone calls as well, 413-736-2781. Shout out to all my haters and enemies who monitor my radio program. It's funny because some of them say stuff like, well, you know, I don't listen to his show. But then they do Facebook Lives and don't talk about anything but what I said on my show. I see you. Hi, hater. Hi, hater. Hi, hater. Dollar bill, y'all. A lot of bills. Okay, let me stop. 413-736-2781 is the number here. 413-736-2781 is the telephone number. Yes, thank you, Francesca, for reminding me. Also, we want to send our condolences out to the family of Miss Mabel Sharif. Dear friends of mine, I did reach out, tried to reach out, and I'm certain he's been fielding a lot of calls to my fraternity brother, Kareem Sharif, on the loss of his mom, Mabel Sharif, Ahmad Sharif, Tammy Sharif, Khalif Sharif, and we go back literally to junior high school. Khalif and I were at, before his name was Khalif, he was Gary Spencer then. Back to Van Sickle Junior High School in the 1970s. Yeah, long time. And so great family in the city. And Miss Mabel was just a staple in our community. And she was always a supporter of mine and of our families. And that's a huge loss personally. And to the city at large. And so certainly our condolences and our prayers are with the Sharif family. 413-736-2781, 413-736-2781. Let me first, now listen, I'm gonna give y'all a chance because I don't know if Facebook gonna try to shut this off. Facebook be tripping, you know, I play certain music and they shut the stream down. It'd be crazy. But anyway, go to WTCCFM.org or go to TuneIn Radio. TuneIn, you can pull up WTCC to get the audio because I think I'm going to have to silence it for you all that are on social media, but those listening on the radio will be able to hear it. This special song I have, let me get this background music out because I want y'all to hear it. I want y'all to really hear it. This song I have dedicated to the fans of the Dallas Cowboys. I mean, yeah, it's a great song. Check it out. Thank you. All right. 413-736-2781. 413-736-2781 is the number here. Any Cowboy fans, you know, who wanna jump in, certainly shout out goes out to Bishop Rudy McKissick, to Dr. Freddie Haynes, to Reverend Howard John Wesley, to my dear brother, Pastor Mark Bayman, Pastor JP Morgan. I'm praying for y'all. Praying for y'all. Yeah. All y'all Cowboy fans. Absolutely. 413-736-2781. They real quiet. Cowboy fans are real quiet this morning. They're real quiet. Woo! Y'all is real quiet. Somebody said we can't hear it on Facebook. I know. I couldn't, because it's got that commercial song in it. Sometimes Facebook literally shuts down my entire stream if I play certain music. So that's why I told y'all to go listen to it on the radio. But you can go to my Instagram page. Go to my Instagram page. The song is up there, and you can hear it. I see you, Jesse Preacher Man Burgess. Good morning to you. Woo! I almost want to play it again. I almost feel tempted to play it again. You know what I'm saying? All right, let me stop. All right, 413-736-2781 is the number here. For the longest time, let me tell you what was happening. Let me tell you exactly what was happening at the time the Cowboys last won a chip. Let me tell y'all exactly what was going on in the world, because, you know, the world was a different place the last time they won a chip. Bill Clinton was the president. Gas was $1.23 per gallon. They last won the Super Bowl when the flip phone was introduced. Okay? The flip phone came out. Did y'all hear what I said? I said they last won a chip when the flip phone went on sale. Tupac released All Eyes on Me. Jay-Z released his debut album, Beyond Reasonable Doubt. All that stuff happened the last time the Cowgirls won a chip. Y'all want to know when the last time they won a chip? All right. 413-736-2781. All right, let me stop messing with y'all Cowboy fans. It has been a long time. I should have played Rakim too. It's been a long time. I shouldn't have left you without a Super Bowl to step to. All right, I'm cutting up this morning. I'm cutting up. All right. 413-736-2781. Put your favorite team in the comment section. All right? Because I know some of y'all Cowboy fans are hiding. Go on. I need y'all to check in. I need y'all to check in right now. Put your favorite team in the comment section. All right? and stop hiding. And y'all Cowboy fans, y'all go on and fess up. If y'all in there, get your favorite team in the comment section. Let's go. Let's go. Stop playing with me. All right. Let's get it in there. Let's get it in there. I see the Saints. I see the Eagles. Frida, you don't count. She had a nerve to say Philadelphia or Houston. You can't be like one or the other. And those aren't even the teams that she liked last year. She changes teams more than a lot of y'all change underwear. 49ers, the Houston Texans. Now you want to say Baltimore? Anyway, that's what I'm talking about, Karen McKnight Hightower. Steelers. Yes. Steelers all day. Mike Muhammad down with the Eagles. Yeah. Mike Muhammad said Dallas do this every year. Yeah, come on, don't be scared. Rep your favorite team. Get it on in there. 413-736-2781. I'm gonna play my favorite MLK speech. This is a speech where he talks about how he was feeling troubled one night, and he got up and sat at the kitchen table thinking about things that were happening in the movement, thinking about the fact that his wife and children could be taken from him or he could be taken from them. He said he was weak, he was faltering, he was losing his courage, and he sat over a cup of coffee, and that's when he really learned to pray. And when religion had to really become real to him, it's a powerful speech and a turning point in his ministry. It's my favorite MLK speech. I want to play it for you this morning on this MLK holiday. Again, put your favorite MLK quote in the comments section. Put your favorite football team in the comments section. We'll highlight your quotes and your teams. Let's take a listen to the drum major for Justice. Let me get the background music out the way. And we'll listen to the man whose legacy and whose life and whose work that we celebrate on this day, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Let me put that on pause just a moment. I want to see if I can find another version because they've got some background music in there. And I'm not sure if that is copyright protected or not. And I don't want Facebook shutting down the stream because of that background music. And they will do that. So I'm going to put on a different speech. And then I'm going to try to search for the one I want, and we'll come back. We'll come back to that one. Let me see if I can find, of course, the one he gave. Oh, here it is. I think I got it right here without the music in the background. Let's see. Let me see. There we go.
And I started preaching there. Things were going well in that church. It was a marvelous experience. But one day, a year later, a lady by the name of Rosa Parks decided that she wasn't going to take it any longer. She stayed in a bus seat. You may not remember it because it's way back now, several years, but it was the beginning of a movement. where 50,000 black men and women refuse absolutely to ride the city buses, and we walk together for 381 days.
Yes, sir.
That's what we got to learn in the North. The Negroes have to learn to stick together. We stuck together. We sent out the call. No Negro rode the buses. It was one of the most amazing things I've ever seen in my life. The people of Montgomery asked me to serve as the spokesman. And as the president of the new organization, the Montgomery Improvement Association, that came into being to lead the boycott, I couldn't say no. And then we started our struggle together. Things were going well for the first few days, but then about 10 or 15 days later, after the white people in Montgomery knew that we meant business, they started doing some nasty things. They started making nasty telephone calls and came to the point that some days more than 40 telephone calls would come in, threatening my life, the life of my family, the life of my children. I took it for a while in a strong manner. But I never will forget one night very late. It was around midnight. And you can have some strange experiences at midnight. I had been out meeting with the steering committee all that night. And I came home. My wife was in the bed, and I immediately crawled into bed to get some rest, to get up early the next morning to try to keep things going. And immediately, the telephone started ringing, and I picked it up. On the other end was an ugly voice. That voice said to me in substance, "Nigger, we are tired of you and your mess now. And if you aren't out of this town in 3 days, we're going to blow your brains out and blow up your house." I heard these things before, but for some reason that night it got to me. I turned over and I tried to go to sleep, but I couldn't sleep. Frustrated, bewildered. And then I got up and went back to the kitchen and I started warming some coffee, thinking the coffee would give me a little relief. And then I started thinking about many things. I pulled back on the theology and philosophy that I had just studied in the universities, trying to give philosophical and theological reasons for the existence and the reality of sin and evil, but the answer didn't quite come there. I sat there and thought about a beautiful little daughter who had just been born about a month earlier. We have 4 children now, but we only had one then. She was the darling of my life. I'd come in night after night and see that little gentle smile. And I sat at that table thinking about that little girl and thinking about the fact that she could be taken away from me in a minute. And I started thinking about a dedicated, devoted, and loyal wife who was over there asleep. She could be taken from me, I could be taken from her. And I got to the point that I couldn't take it any longer. I was weak. And something said to me, you can't call on daddy now. He's up in Atlanta, 175 miles away. You can't even call on mama now. You got to call on that something and that person that your daddy used to tell you about. That power that can make a way out of no way. I discovered then that religion had to become real to me, and I had to know God for myself. I bowed down over that cup of coffee. I never will forget it. Oh, yes, I prayed a prayer, and I prayed out loud that night. I said, Lord, I'm down here trying to do what's right. I think I'm right. I think the cause that we represent is right. But Lord, I must confess that I'm weak now. I'm faltering. I'm losing my courage. Seemed at that moment that I could hear an inner voice saying to me, Martin Luther, stand up for righteousness. Stand up for justice. Stand up for truth. And lo, I will be with you even unto the end of the world. I tell you, I've seen the lightning flash. I've heard the thunder roar. I felt sin breakers dashing, trying to conquer my soul. But I heard the voice of Jesus saying, still to fight on. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. No, never alone. No, never alone. He promised never to leave me. Never to leave me alone. Sometimes I feel discouraged. And I don't mind telling you this morning that sometimes I feel discouraged. I felt discouraged in Chicago. As I moved through Mississippi and Georgia and Alabama, I feel discouraged. Living every day under the threat of death, I feel discouraged sometimes. Living every day under extensive criticism, even from Negroes, I feel discouraged sometimes. Yes, sometimes I feel discouraged and feel my works in vain. But then the Holy Spirit revives my soul again. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. God bless you.
413-736-2781. That was Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. talking about his entrance into the civil rights movement. It is what I think is one of his most powerful speeches that gives us a glimpse into his vulnerability and how he pulled on his faith in a particular moment when he needed it the most. You know, he said, "You can't call on daddy." You know, daddy's up in Atlanta. You've got to call on that somebody that your daddy used to tell you about. Just a powerful speech to me. Of course, I know on this day you're going to hear all about I Have a Dream, but thank you all for putting in your quotes. Hal Swan, shout out to my cuz, says his favorite is, if you want to say I was a drum major, say that I was a drum major for justice, peace, and righteousness. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hello, I was just calling to tell you that I remember the Rosa Parks. I was in high school. My father, James Henry Morris, and I remember Reverend Abernathy, Reverend Steele, and Reverend Jackson marched. There were some of the ministers that marched with Reverend King during that Rosa Parks march. And we were told not to get on the buses, that somebody would be there every bus stop to pick us up and bring us home for free. So I remember those days, and I think about them all the time, and I just pray for his family.
Amen. Thank you much. Thanks for sharing your memories.
Okay, I'm Effie Ware.
All right. Appreciate you sharing your memory. A lot of the folks who were around during that time, many of them are gone. So those who are yet with us and can share those memories, those are valuable memories to share, and certainly appreciate that. 413-736-2781. What does the legacy of Dr. King mean to you? Jesse Preacher Man Burgess says, darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. It's his favorite MLK quote. And we're asking you to put your favorite quotes in the comment section. Also to rep your favorite football team. Once again, for those who are wondering when the last time the Cowboys won a championship, let me remind you again. All right. 413-736-2781 is the number here. This one here is his mountaintop, what we call his mountaintop speech. It's a portion of it. He gave this. Now, a lot of the history books, when I was growing up, the history books said he gave it at Masonic Temple in Memphis. I took it at face value, you know, that the history books were right. It wasn't until later I learned, and I learned it because I'm part of the Church of God in Christ, that it was at Mason Temple Church of God in Christ, our world headquarters in Memphis, Tennessee, that he gave that speech. Now, I've been able to stand in that pulpit hundreds of times, being a national officer in the Church of God in Christ. Stand at that very place where Dr. King gave his last speech. He gave it at Mason Temple, and then went to stay at the Lorraine Motel, which is now the National Civil Rights Museum. I've been there many, many times. Went to the Lorraine Motel and was assassinated the next day on April 4th, 1968. But this speech he gave on April 3rd, 1968, eerily prophetic about not getting there with you. But take a listen to it. It's my second most favorite MLK speech after the one I just played. This is some excerpts from, let me see if I can get it up. I thought I had it. Yeah, some excerpts from his mountaintop speech.
In the Civil Rights Bill, if I had sneezed, I wouldn't have had a chance later that year in August to try to tell America about a dream that I had had if I had sneezed. I wouldn't have been down in Selma, Alabama to see the great movement there if I had sneezed. I wouldn't have been in Memphis to see a community rally around those brothers and sisters who are suffering. I'm so happy that I didn't sneeze. And they were telling me, now it doesn't matter now. It really doesn't matter what happens now. I left Atlanta this morning, and as we got started on the plane, there were six of us. The pilot said over the public address system, we are sorry for the delay. But we have Dr. Martin Luther King on the plane. And to be sure that all of the bags were checked. And to be sure that nothing would be wrong on the plane, we had to check out everything carefully. And we've had the plane protected and guarded all night. And then I got into Memphis. And some began to say the threats, or talk about the threats that were out. Or what would happen to me from some of our sick white brothers. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
413-736-2781. That is the mountaintop speech that he gave the night before he was assassinated in Memphis, Tennessee. Another very powerful speech. Let me give you some quotes. Let me get Brother Walker up in the space, and then I want to close out with giving you some quotes that you're not going to hear today. You're going to see quotes all over the place. You're going to see right wing Republicans, Democrats, white supremacists. You're going to see all kinds of folk quoting Dr. King today. People whose lives are completely antithetical to everything he lived and died for. They're going to claim the mantle of Dr. King. They're going to misquote Dr. King. They're going to bastardize his quotes. They're going to apply his quotes to themselves. Judge by the content of your character, not the color of your skin, and try to apply that to white folks when that's not what he meant. You're going to see all of that happen today. That's the reason why. Go back and listen to my Friday broadcast where I talked about reclaiming MLK, the radical revolutionary Martin Luther King. Brother Walker, you're in the space.
Good morning, Bishop. Happy Martin Luther King Day to you.
Same to you.
It's kind of funny hearing some of those speeches I'd heard, and it's wild that he's fight against some who look like some of his own skin folk who were fighting him every step of the way, too. I think we forget that sometimes, that we still have that in the present day, unfortunately.
Yes, sir. You know, at the time of his death, he had a 23% approval rating among white folks and only a 45% approval rating among black folks.
Yeah, so I just wanted to thank you for doing this, and this is an excellent way to celebrate his legacy and his work. So that's all I wanted to say, brother.
All right, appreciate you, man. Let me get Untouchable Jay in the space. You got the microphone, Jay.
Bishop, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Yes, sir. Just wanted to, you know, first thank you for being one of our most recent trailblazers and people who continue the spirit of MLK to this day for our people. The approval rating you just stated is mind-blowing in that time, that people would rather settle for a level of oppression than a greater level of freedom.
Yeah.
And definitely thank you for this broadcast, because every MLK Day, I'm happy, but I'm also saddened because of the misquotes and the pandering to especially Democratic shills to try to, you know, go one-sided. But MLK was a staunch pro-Black reparationalist. He was pro-humanist. He was just for everyone, but he was for us first. I'll land there. God bless.
Appreciate you, brother. Yeah, he had turned his attention to the Vietnam War, and it turned folks against him, including President Lyndon Baines Johnson, who he worked with to pass and sign into law the Voting Rights Act. Johnson stopped taking his calls and stopped associating with him because they then considered him to be unpatriotic and un-American because he spoke out against the Vietnam War. Let me get Alistair in here as our last commenter, and then I'll give you a couple of quotes and close out. You got the microphone, Alistair.
Yes, brother. How you doing this morning?
I'm good. You?
I just want to say, you know, keep up, keep doing the work. Let's keep doing Dr. Martin Luther King's work. The most important thing that we need to push on is for what he was calling for when he was saying, we're coming to get our check.
Yes.
Whatever you are, a Democrat, Republican, whatever party you're affiliated, you need to push and demand that your elected officials, leaders, even people from the private sectors, that we demand reparations here in the United States for Black people.
Absolutely.
Thank you, brother.
Appreciate you. Absolutely. And a lot of folks don't understand that part of MLK's history. He was planning a second march on Washington. Actually, a third, because there was one in 1957. One in 1963 is the one we remember and memorialize in history. But they were planning a march on Washington as part of his Poor People's Campaign. And as part of his Poor People's Campaign, he said, when we get to Washington, we're coming to get our check. He was definitely about reparations. And see, this is how they'll bastardize his legacy, because these right wingers will tell you Dr. King wouldn't have supported reparations. He wouldn't have wanted a handout. He would have wanted you to pull yourself up by your bootstrap. Dr. King talked about the fact that this government gave immigrants, white European immigrants, a leg up by subsidizing them. And he talked about how unfair that was. When you had Black people who had been here for generations, that same government refused to help, and that government's policies is what put them in the predicament that they were in. And he said, when we come to Washington, we're coming to get our check. So Dr. King definitely was about reparations. Let me give you, as I close this out, some of the quotes y'all ain't gonna hear. You're not going to hear them. You're not going to see them posted today. You know, some of our listeners posted some quotes that you wouldn't normally hear. But these are the ones you're not going to see the politicians. You're going to see a whole lot of being judged by the content of your character and not the color of your skin. You're going to see that a lot. But you're not going to see this. Dr. King said, a nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death. Dr. King said, the evils of capitalism are as real as the evils of militarism and racism. The problems of racial injustice and economic injustice cannot be solved without a radical redistribution of political and economic power. Dr. King said this, the price that America must pay for the continued oppression of the Negro and other minority groups is the price of its own destruction. Dr. King said, white Americans must recognize that justice for Black people cannot be achieved without radical changes in the structure of our society. Dr. King said, "We know through painful experience that freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed." And I want to give you one that's probably one of my favorite MLK quotes that, you know, I remember one time putting this particular quote up without putting Dr. King's name by it. And I did that on purpose because I wanted to see people's reaction to this particular quote. And it was amazing because they were calling me all kinds of racist, all kinds of bigots, yada, yada, yada. And then they were flabbergasted when I revealed that it was an MLK quote. Dr. King said this, "I am sad to say that most white people are racist, either consciously or unconsciously." Let me say that again. Because see, that's one of them quotes you ain't gonna see that plastered all over X, used to be Twitter. You're not gonna see that all over Facebook today. You're not gonna see that on your Instagram thread today. "I am sad to say that most white people are racist, either consciously or unconsciously." Happy Martin Luther King Jr. Day. I hope you have a fantabulous, talrific MLK Day today. Whatever you're doing to celebrate the holiday, I pray it goes well for you. You have an opportunity to reflect on the legacy of Dr. King. I'll take this last phone call. I was just shutting down the phone line. Good morning, caller. You're the last one. Caller? All right. Somebody decided they want to play at the last minute. All right. I got to get out your way because mid-morning jazz is coming up right now. Mid-morning jazz is coming up. I got to move out your way. It's around. Y'all starting to call in. It's 10 o'clock. Stop playing with me. All right. Let me do it one more time. You're the last caller of the day. Good morning.
Hello?
Yes. Good morning.
Hello?
All right. They'll figure it out. So listen, go on downtown. To the MLK celebration that's being held at the Mass Mutual Center. It's going on right now. A lot of great stuff is happening downtown. Performances, talent, speeches, awards, you name it, it's popping. We're celebrating Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. If you're looking for a place to worship, check us out at the Spring of Hope Church of God in Christ, 35 Alden Street, Springfield, Massachusetts, the Brick Church, right there at Six Corners. There'll be prayer, praise, and preaching. We're building better tomorrows by changing lives today. Check me out on Friday on the Black Love Experience. I'm out of here. I'm going to go get me some fish and some grits, and then I'm going down to celebrate MLK. Until the next time I talk to you and you talk to me, always remember, God loves you, and so do I. Peace and blessings.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm fine. I was about to say, I'll wait till you turn off. Condolences about Maxine.
Thank you.